at a customer side, we might have heard this name like SAP ECC, SAP HANA, SAP S/4HANA. Many names comes to the picture. So we don't actually know what these tools are actually. The only thing that we know is that these tools are marketed by SAP. So in this session, we'll try to understand the difference between all these things, and we'll make sure every doubt gets clear. So let's move on to the topics that we'll be covering today. So at the end of this session, you will know what ERP is, a quick overview of SAP, the products it's offering, S/4HANA. And finally, we'll be connecting our BI tool with SAP HANA. I'll be showing you the physical installation of the ODBC driver. And finally, we'll have the post-integration challenges. What are the challenges that you are likely to face at the customer side? So I have splitted this session in two parts. First, we'll understand the basic concepts of SAPs till SAP S/4HANA, and post that we'll see how the installation works. So first thing to discuss over here is what is SAP, what is ERP, and why do we require it? So the point of bringing this to notice is because it has direct connection with the SAP system. So first we'll understand what is ERP. ERP stands for Enterprise Resource Planning. So in order to give a broader understanding for this concept, I have a flow diagram over here. We'll try to go through that and understand this. So let's suppose in a typical enterprise business, I have let's assume a manufacturing company. So what in manufacturing company happens is you have a customer approaching to you. Okay. Customer wants a particular product. Okay. The customer will go to the salesperson and ask that whether the product is available or not. If it is available, then in how many days can it be delivered to me? So what the salesperson is responsible for making the sales initiative. So the salesperson does not have much knowledge about whether the product is present or not. So what he will do is he will contact the inventory team and ask for the availability of the product. So let's assume a scenario over here. What if the inventory manager is busy on some other work or is not available to pick up the call of the sales manager? So what will happen is the salesperson will end up getting less information from the inventory manager, and he won't be able to answer all the questions of the customer. So What will happen is the customer will not be satisfied with the business with this particular enterprise and will end up not buying the product. Okay, so this is one possible scenario that can happen if a company is less informed about his or own product. So one more scenario. So we have considered one case over here that the inventory manager is not present. So again, go back to the same scenario and assume that all the people are actually present. They are not busy with some other call. So they are whenever you give a phone call to them, they are ready to answer your call. So similarly, customer comes in, asks the sales manager for the product. The sales manager goes to the inventory manager and checks whether the product is available or not. If the product is available, then he will hand it over to the salesperson, and the salesperson will in turn hand it over to the customer. But what if the product is not available? The salesperson contacted the inventory manager, but the inventory manager just said that the product is not available. So the sales manager will then go to the planning team to asking for the whether the product can be made available or not. So the planning team is actually responsible for the complete management of the product. It should be made available when a customer comes in or stuff like that. So what the planning team will do is it will ask for the raw material. What are the raw material that I would be require in order to manufacture the product? So in order to check the raw material is available or not, he will contact the inventory team and ask, is the raw material available? So if the raw material is available, he will buy that raw material from the inventory, or he'll just pick up the raw material from the inventory and forward it to the manufacturing team in order to manufacture the product. But what if the raw material is also not available over here? So you need a vendor for that in order to purchase the raw material. So the planning team will contact a particular vendor, and the vendor will in turn deliver the raw material to the planning team, which in turn will go to the manufacturing team in order to manufacture the product. So once the product is manufactured, the manufacturing team will handle it to the salesperson, who will then give the product to the customer. Now, during this process, many financials have been raised by different departments. Like the planning will raise the finance related to the vendor. The manufacturing will have their own cost. So all the financial will be raised. So everything will be then forwarded to the finance team. On top of this process, the billing that needs to be done to the vendor is also then forwarded to the finance team, and any manpower or labor work needed during this process will be then forwarded to the HR department. Now, let's understand the implication of this particular process. Let's suppose the planning team fails to inform the finance team that you need to make a payment to the vendor's team. To our own vendor. So what will happen is the billing will then be paid late after the delivery of the product, and the vendor will then lose the interest in selling the product, selling the raw materials, etc., to the enterprise. Similarly, if suppose any manpower is needed at the different departments, so this will end up the HR team being hiring the manpower at a sufficient higher cost than it can, if it has time to negotiate with the person involved in that, it can give a it can purchase the manpower at a much, much cheaper cost. So this is how the entire business process works to any manufacturing company. So this is the example which I gave over here is a decentralized system. Every department has to speak to other department in order to get the information. The word decentralized over here means that the information of other departments is actually present within the department and not made public to other department as well. So this type of business process has many implications resulting in poor business with the customers. So some key points that get noticed over here is a typical enterprise has many different department and business unit like the one we saw just over here, finance team, HR team, manufacturing this, etc. This department continuously communicate and exchange the data with each other. Like one has to know the status of the other department, just the example which I just gave to you. The success of any organization lies in its effective communication and data exchange within the department or BU as well as associated third parties, vendors, outsourcers, and customers. So if I run a decentralized system, then these are some of the problems that I'll be facing. But what if I have stored all my information at a single place and made this available to other department as well, so that they don't have dependency of calling the other departments in order to get the information. So that's what a centralized system comes in, wherein all the information gets stored at a particular place. And now what happens is, if the customer comes to the salesperson, he can log into the system and check whether the product is available or not, rather than calling the inventory person and knowing whether the product is available or not. So this reduces the problem that if the inventory manager is not available, this can also this will give a solution for the salesperson right on that platform. Similarly, all the invoices that will be raised for this particular vendor will go into the system, and finance will then pick up the invoices and pay to the vendor, so that the vendor's interest will also not lose in the company, and a fair business will be made over here. HR will be informed about the resources that they needed, and they can manage to hire the resources at a sufficient fair price rather than paying higher because of the increased demand. Similarly, everything will be managed securely over here in a centralized system, where you don't have any dependency on other department, whether they are present or not. So this is This is what an ERP system does. It manages all your information at a particular place and allow you to connect to the multiple department at the same time. So now so what the benefit of the ERP system is, it eliminates the duplication, discontinuity and redundancy in the data. So any data will not get duplicated because each and every entry will be entered only once. And the other department involved in that will pick up that entry from that and update their statuses on that. On top of that, provides information across departments in real time. So what happens is you don't have to wait for the data to be updated. Every information is up to date. Whatever processes will happen, everything will be updated on the system. Provides control over various business process. Like the way I said, the salesperson knows the statuses of every other department, the inventory department, the manufacturing, planning, etc. Everything is readily available on the system. So you don't have to wait for that and gets the control over all the business processes. Now this increases the productivity, better inventory management, reduces material cost and effective human resource management. And finally, it boosts the profit. So this is what we have just discussed. So the point of making this realize is the SAP is also an ERP system. So if you go to the few further slides, SAP stands for System Resource and Planning. SAP itself is an ERP system wherein a centralized ERP system wherein all your data gets captured, all the organization data gets captured at a single place, and other members of the other departments of the organization can access that data and give a fairer productivity of them. So just quickly, information about SAP, it's a system application and program. It's one of the number one software in the market currently. It's a German software company founded in 1972 with headquarters in Germany. So roughly speaking, all the German markets, if you need an ERP product, then SAP is the one. This product has boosted the market since a very long time, except for the US market wherein Microsoft is at a very large scale. Microsoft Dynamics, it's also an ERP product. So in US, a little bit of less usage of SAP as compared to Microsoft. But in other markets, SAP is at the topmost level. Okay, so coming to the product evolution, like the agenda for adding this slide over here is, if you might have noticed that around 2 to 3 weeks back, we have something a session on SAP ECC. Now we have something on SAP HANA. Then you might have also heard of something on S4 HANA. So just we'll try to understand the difference between all this thing using this flow diagram over here. So the first product that was launched by SAP is R1. R over here stands for real-time processing, and one is the number of tires of the system applied to it. Similarly, R2 and R3 was also released. We'll go and understand R1, R2, R3 because it will helpful for us to understand the ECC and its architecture. So let's quickly jump to the slide and we'll come back to this one slide ahead. Okay. So first we have the R1 architecture. Like the one I said, the one stands over here for single tire. So in order to run a SAP application, you need to have a multiple, a component inside the system. So first, the three main system for SAP is the client layer, application layer, and the database layer. You can assume the client layer as the UI, the screen that you actually see on the Chrome or it's a desktop application, the one that you see, a complete UI kind of stuff. Second, you have the application layer, and finally the database layer. So I'll try to explain you what all these three layers represent in an SAP system. So first, let's understand the client layer. So what the client layer does is, let's suppose you need an information of a particular department. Give an example to you. The salesperson needs the information of the inventory, or it's like it can be the other way as well. The inventory person needs to update some information into the system. Okay. So what the person will do is he will go to the UI of the screen and enter all the necessary information. It will then go to the application layer. So what the application layer does is it acts as a processor. Like it will process your information to the database. It has many components involved under that application layer as well. First, you have the dispatcher wherein it assesses the whether the information that you are entering is correct or not. Once the information is assessed by the dispatcher, then it will send the data to the work process. So in order to explain this in a layman language, let's assume a financial institution such as a bank. So the only condition over here is let's assume a condition that you can't speak with any of the bank employees. You just have to follow the normal procedure in order to get your job done. So you enter a bank, there are many persons sitting over here. So let's suppose you are, depending upon what other transaction you want to do, entering money to a savings account, mutual fund or shares, anything, you fill up the necessary forms for that. So filling up the necessary forms is like the UI, the client layer, which I am speaking here. Then once that is done, you give this to some employee sitting in a bank. So that employee will then assess whether this information is correct or not. So that is what we call as the application layer. Once that is assessed, the person which you have handed over the form will then send it to some other department, which we call as a work process over here, who will in turn do all the the paperwork and all, everything, etc. So that's what we call the work process over here. And once everything is cleared, this will be then sent to the database. Your money will be then given to you from the locker. The locker is, you can assume it as a database. So this is what the three components of the R1 system is: client, application and the database. So when this product was launched in 1972, the dependency over here was everything, the client layer, the application layer and the database layer has to be installed on a single system. You don't have the multiple system, you cannot use multiple system in order to install this product. The client, application and the database, everything has to be installed on the same system. But in early 70s, this was the use case. But as the days progressed, the company size increased. The client was not the only person, there was not only one single client who is accessing all the system. There is obviously multiple users sitting in your offices to access the database. So this product was then redeveloped in order to help the many customers to operate the same product at the same time. So then R2 was released. The 2 year stands for the two-layer architecture. So what this gives you is you can assess n number of clients over here with the application and the application layer and the database layer installed on the same system, whereas the client can be come from any other system. Like I am one client over here, I have to access a database, so I can operate from it from my system, but the application and the database will be then installed on the same system. This also resulted in many problems. The reason behind this is the R2 was released in 80s, and during 80s the major two database providers were IBM and Oracle. So what happens is, if you have any other database rather than the IBM and Oracle, SAP has to the version should be compatible with using that database. So it involves dependency that only if you have this database, then only you can buy the product. Otherwise, you won't be able to purchase the product. So SAP then finally reintroduce something known as R3 in the late 90s. So what this will do is it is separate all these three things into a separate instance, like the three-layer architecture. The client will be completely different, the application will be completely different, and the database will also be completely different. So this involves reduces the dependency that all these three has to be installed on the same system, or it can be installed anywhere and you just have to access this. So the moving back to the R slide. So this is what the entire architecture was for R1, R2 and R3. Moving back to our previous slide, in late 2004, R3 was renamed to ECC. So the one which you have understood in some previous session, like the SAP ECC, is nothing but the it contains the R3 kind of architecture. So this was actually renamed in 2004 by SAP. SAP renamed its core ERP product to SAP Central Component, SAP ERP, and now changed interface. So if you heard someone speaking that we are using SAP ERP or R3 environment, is nothing but the SAP ECC. The only difference is that the database that you are using over here is your own database, rather than like own in sense, it can be of any particular database like the Microsoft or Oracle or anything. It can use any of the database. So now this entire application has dominated the market from a very long time, but soon after SAP has realized that the computing power that it requires to in order to process the end user's request is sufficiently taking a little longer time than it should take. So in order to overcome this challenge, SAP has launched a product known as SAP HANA. So what HANA does is, HANA has an in-memory data processing. It's a column-oriented. The word in-memory over here means it does not need a physical system in order to store its data. Everything gets stored in its RAM. And if you try to enter any of the command, all the things will be computed right from its memory. You don't need to have a physical storage for that. It also has a column oriented RDBMS structure. The column oriented here means all your data's internal, like it's a little technical term over here. So all your data gets stored in a columnar format. So it has come to notice that as compared to the row type database storing, columnar data storage actually processes the information at a much faster rate. Like Amazon Redshift is also using a columnar data storage, whereas all other RDBMS like the PostgreSQL, Microsoft SQL are kind of having a structure of row level database storing platform. In addition to this, it also gives you advanced analytics and includes ETL capabilities as well and runs as an application server as well. So all the three components, the client, application, and the database, in-memory processing of the database, is combined into a single product, and this completely reduces the dependency of like the R1, R2, R3 structure. The scenario I just have explained to you to over here. So this reduces every dependency. So now SAP HANA got split into two parts. One was released in 2015 with the name SAP S4 HANA, and one a cloud-based S4 HANA. So let's understand what this is. So SAP S4 HANA is actually SAP HANA only, but it is a future ready enterprise business tool, including many of the predictive analysis part, the AI, machine learning, everything gets covered into this. Apart from this, in S4 HANA, you have a UI known as SAP Fiori, which is an award-winning UI designed by SAP, which gives you instant analysis of your data in the form of visual analytics. Now, in any of the organization, you will be, if anyone is using SAP S4 HANA, SAP HANA, then you will be finding this three business suite that they will be using. SAP Business Suite on HANA, this is nothing but an ECC system. The only difference is that the database, instead of putting any database, it is using SAP in-memory database known as SAP HANA. Then I have SAP S4 HANA Finance. This is similar to the SAP Business Suite on HANA, but only difference is that so there is some modification that has been done to the finance module. Then we have SAP S4 Enterprise Management. This is the key feature that SAP S4 produces. This gives you an entire clear picture of managing your enterprise. So this is also a business suite that SAP has released. The flexibility of SAP HANA, S4 HANA, is it is cloud-based platform. You can deploy it on cloud as well. The customer that I'm working with currently is using a cloud-based SAP S/4HANA. It gives you a perfect user experience with the help of SAP Fiori, wherein you can use it to reproduce a very good understanding of your data, plus added analytics. Then the benefit of using S/4HANA is you can integrate data from multiple sources. Can integrate the data coming from a finance or manufacturing. Everything will can come into a single sources over here. Speed of deployment. Usually the deployment of any ERP tool takes 6 months, depending upon the internal usage of it. So how many people are likely to use it at a faster rate, but the deployment is quite fast over here. And flexibility to meet the changing needs. This feature also SAP provides over here. Then we have embedded analytics as well. You can directly deploy this tool at your website, like we have at the Team Computers website. You can use embedded analytics to deploy this tool on our website as well. So this is what everything was related to the S/4HANA. So like some the last session we have a question that can Tableau connect to SAP ECC. So yes, it can connect to the SAP ECC. The only thing that we need to know over here is the database that it was using. So once we have the information of the database, we can connect to the directly to through that database, and we can get all the necessary information. So if you are deployed to any of the customer and they are using SAP as their database, so few questions that we need to ask them, that what is the category of the product that you are using? Is it SAP ECC or is it HANA or S/4HANA? What is the product that we are using? Once you know all this information, you don't have to connect to the application layer. You just have to connect to the database layer in order to get the information. For ECC, you need to know the database, whereas irrespective of HANA or S/4HANA, you have to just have to hit the HANA database in order to get the information. So this was a journey of the SAP right from R1 till S/4HANA. Next, we will be speaking about the physical installation of this product, like how can you directly integrate your BI tool with this particular product. So in order to install that, let's suppose you go to a customer and they tell you that give me a complete requirement that what all the things that you need in order to integrate your BI tool with this particular product. So there are some requirements that you need to ask your customer on the day one, so they can manage and give this to you, and you can then integrate the tool much more efficiently. First, what you need is the SAP portal login credentials. This is the username and password that is made on behalf of you by the SAP. So you need to obtain this from the SAP or the one who is responsible for getting the SAP tool in this organization. High-end dedicated system with Tableau Desktop of you can have any of your BI tool over here. I have just mentioned the Tableau Desktop here. Then sufficient access for running script using like the you need to run few script. Like this is not the same way as you do other installation of the ODBC driver. You have to run a script in order to make the UI available to you. I'll show this soon in the further slides. You need to have a sufficient access, like the admin access. You need to run the script as an administrator. You just need to obtain it from the IT person of your team. Then server IP address and port number for the database accessing for SAP HANA user account credential with sufficient privileges. So SAP server IP address, this is nothing but the IP address for the database contain like the table the schema containing your table. So this is the information for that, as well as a port number. It has multiple ports number, so you need to get the information of that as well. Then SAP HANA user account credentials with sufficient privileges, like the privileges by mentioning privileges, I mean key. You need to have a read access over here. If you don't have a read access, then even though you have a user account, then you won't be able to connect to SAP over here. Then schema and table name of the data stored, which schema and which table are we going to access in order to connect to our BI tool. And we have SAP HANA Studio, which is optional over here. I personally found SAP HANA Studio useful. Reason behind that, it helps us to validate our data very much easily. like before entering into the BI phase, if you want to know that, okay, this is the some of the requirements that we need to develop, but what is the number which is coming in our system, is it correct or not? So in order to be going before entering the BI tool, we can run the SQL query. So all the SQL queries get executed at the HANA Studio level. Apart from this, if the customer is less educated about the port number or schema table, you can also get all that information from the SAP HANA Studio. There is an administrative page in HANA Studio wherein it gives you a complete detail of the port numbers you are using, the schema and the table name you are using. So all this information you can obtain from the HANA Studio. So now let's move on to what are the things that we required in order to do the installation. So first, while connecting to the Tableau desktop native connector of SAP HANA over here, the one I have highlighted over here, you just have to use this SAP HANA. It will prompt for a download and install the drivers and then connect. It will not allow you to connect until and unless you install this driver. Now, in order to install this driver, you have to follow a particular a procedure in order to get the drivers. So in order to get the drivers, you need SAP portal. Now, what this does is it actually stores the ODBC driver, but everyone cannot access this. Only the person who are a valid SAP user can access this. So this is, you just have to go to the Google and enter SAP portal. You will be coming up to this screen. And over here, if you can see over here, there is a software and downloads page over here. You just have to first let's log into the page. My password got actually changed for this particular product, because of which I'm not able to show you the entire UI. So once you enter the password, you will be coming to the screen and you just have to enter the software downloads. Now, once you enter this software download, this is the SAP marketplace, wherein all the products related to the HANA Studio, the ODBC driver, everything is placed over here. So in the search box, just enter HANA client and you will be coming to the screen. Choose SAP HANA client 1.00. There is also one version 2.0, but in order to make a system compatible, a 64-bit version, SAP HANA client is more suitable. Then once you click on the HANA client, the SAP HANA client 1.00, you will be coming to the screen and choose the IMDb client with the latest version, the one with the latest release date. The reason behind that is there is multiple bug fixes that happens with respect to any tool, not just SAP. It can be with respect to your BI tool as well. So you need to choose the one with the latest release date. So technically speaking, it covers most of the bugs that comes to the system. So you just have, once you click on this, it will automatically allow you to download this. Apart from this, you just have to download one more thing. Go back to the same procedure and search for the SAP CAR, SAP CAR. This is an EXE application. You also need a installation of this. So I'll explain you what this is. So basically, let's assume somebody has sent you a zip file wherein all your information is being compressed under that particular folder. So you need a zip extractor in order to open that, right? So SAP CAR runs as a zip extractor. It extracts all the necessary file that we want from this particular downloaded application, IMDb client 100. Once you have these two things, you have to follow this procedure. So these two slides I'll be explaining by running it out locally on my system. So I have this particular folder, PCPL SAP demo. So I have the IMDb client downloaded and I have the SAP CAR. So what you need to do is just copy this path, search for command prompt from the search engine. Right click and do run as administrator. So what run as administrator does is it will allow you to install any system if it is being blocked by the administrator. So I have the administrator access in my system. So I'm using run as administrator. Once you come to this screen, you just have to enter. Let me make this full screen. You just have to enter cd
and copy the file path. What CD does is it changes the directory to this particular folder, PCPL SAP demo, because we need to extract the files from this particular folder and place all the necessary dependency on that folder as well. So I'm going to this folder by using the command CD. And once you are done with this, you just have to press enter. Now you are landed on that particular folder. Now just press on tab. It will give you two options. First, enter SAP SCAR space XVF. This is an extractor that I am running. Then space. Then again, give a space and press tab. And this is the IMDb client which you want to extract. Just enter this line properly. I have mentioned this in my PPT as well. You can refer to that. And just press enter. Now this is getting all the necessary packages are getting installed in that particular folder. Once this is done, we can navigate to that folder and do the direct installation. And this everything got installed. So just, if you go back to this thing, you will notice that SAP HANA client is a folder of SAP HANA client is installed over here. So now you are at the same phase, the one the thing which you do for any of the ODBC driver, like the PostgreSQL ODBC driver. You just have to download it from the internet and you just have to install it. So this is now we are landing at the page where you are doing everything like the same way as before. But SAP gives you a complete UI wherein you can install the ODBC driver. So just double click on this. It will ask you a few questions and it will allow you to install the ODBC driver. So this is install new SAP database client, the place where I want to install this. Just click on the next. Don't change any default settings. Click on next. Just a second. Okay. So these are the things that will be installed on my system. ODBC driver name HDB ODBC, and these are the necessary components that it will get installed in my system. Just click on the install, and it will install in within a minute. It will get installed in my system. So what happens is most of the time is that in your system, in the user account, C and C++ are not installed. So this will throw up an error. So what you need to do is you need to change your login and run and login from the administrator. So what happens is for a particular user, the C++ programs are not installed, but for the admin, it is installed. So once you switch the program, you will not see this error. So since I have everything in my system, so I did not end up with any error. So my ODBC client has just got installed in my system. And now if I close this everything and move to my Tableau desktop, I'm showing over here to connect with Tableau. You can assume that it is your BI tool and you just have to use the native connector in order to connect. Just a second. So all these installation steps are actually written in the PPT. You can just follow the steps. You know, if you want to install the ODBC driver, and once the ODBC driver is installed, you just have to click on SAP Native Connector in order to connect to the database. So, okay, so this is my Tableau desktop UI. You can assume with respect to any of your BI tool, the one you are operating. So I have a servo option over here, and these are the number of connectors that Tableau allows me to connect. So I'm choosing SAP HANA from here. And you can see over here, there is no requirement of installing the driver because everything is installed. So I have used this previously, so it's allowing me to give a, so automatically it has entered the server name and the port number.
Okay, so in order to connect, I need to log into my VPN. And if I enter my password, it will go to the SAP HANA database. And you can see over here, it has connected to the SAP HANA database. You need to enter the schema name over here, which is SAP BEP in my case. And all the necessary tables will then be displayed over here. So I have a table name known as ZMMPUR. So this is my table name. I'm getting that into my view. And my data is connected to my BI tool is now integrated with the SAP HANA database. So this is all the data that is coming to my system. So this is how you need to install the necessary ODBC driver in order to integrate your BI tool with the system. I don't know about what is the native connector. Is it offering by Qlik or Alteryx or any other BI tool? But this is how you are supposed to connect to the database. So coming back to our slide, so this is everything written over here, documented over here. You need what are the things that you need to install and how do you need to operate this. And once this is done, you just have to enter the port number ID and your SAP database is now integrated with Tableau Desktop and ready for use. So once this installation is done, there are some challenges that you are likely to be faced at the customer. So I have listed this over here. Now column names gets unknown. The one which you just saw, this is something that a kind of a tabular format. But once you enter the Tableau Desktop UI, these are the table names. So the people who don't know about the Tableau Desktop. So data gets split into two parts, one with dimension and one with measure. All the string, days, etc. goes to dimension and all the numeric part goes as measure. So the one which you are seeing over as a green pin is measure and the one with blue are the dimensions. So if you see over here, this is completely not able to understand as well what field represent what. So this is one problem with SAP that you won't be able to change the column name. It has to be done on the backend part, but none of the ABAP developers, the one who has written this table, they are not likely to change this. So this is one problem that you are likely to face at the customer side. We do have a solution for this, but if possible, please make them change this because it will help you to analyze your data well without taking iteration at your tool level. So this is one point. Other point is that the data type is unrecognized. So what happens is if your data has a date column, so SAP HANA fails to recognize that as a date column. So in your BI tool as well, it will be represented as string. So I have ERDAT over here. ERDAT is my PO documented date. So if I drag this, it is actually a date, but the data type is not recognized. So many BI tool has this capability. It will automatically recognize whether the data that contains in your database is a string or a numeric or a date. So you need to manually go and change it to a date format. So this is one more additional thing that you are supposed to do while operating SAP HANA. Other than this, the renaming thing. So how we have tackled the renaming over here is, you just have to create in Tableau, you have to create a calculated field with the same name. It can be different for Qlik as Alteryx is completely different. It can be different for Qlik. You just have to rename this. It allows you to rename, but once you replace this data, it will go back to the previous state. So I just have to create a calculated field. I'll use that for ERDAT. Create a calculated field and just rename this to the one which you want. So I'll write this as POD. And if you use this table in future for any of the other connecting to any other for any other purpose, you just have to copy this particular PO date and just place that into that particular table. It allows you to copy and you have to open the other instance of Tableau and just paste that. So You don't need to do this renaming again and again. Only one time you need to do, and other time you need to copy and paste. So this is how this problem is tackled at Tableau desktop level. The scenario can be different in other tools, but this is one possible solution that we have in order to tackle this problem. Now, the third point is the width of the data becomes 2x. So the meaning of this is you have your end, let's assume that this table contains 50 columns. After renaming, only 20 columns are, so let's suppose we are using 20 columns. So after renaming, it will get multiplied by two, like the total number that we will be coming up with will be 70. And the 30s are, so the 50 columns are not useful at all, because we are only working with the 20 columns. So the data width is increasing. In a typical enterprise, we are on an average, we do have average 10 lakh rows, but width of the data is too big, then it will obviously take some time to process. So this is one problem of SAP HANA. The width increases much dynamically in order for the renaming part. So what you can do is Tableau allows you to extract the data. So before placing the data into extract, you just need to hide all the unused columns. So this will in turn shorten, width of the data gets shortened, and the performance will also boost up with this product. Next point to discuss is that, yes.
Hi, Pramod. Hi. So I just want to ask if you can see that there are so many issues when you're connecting directly with Tableau. Mm-hmm. Why would the detail layer added? I mean, that could be a solution, right, to capture all the data and make the data name changes and everything.
Agreed. So we do have Tableau Prep as an ETL tool over here. We have already pitched this to the customer, but the customer does not have fair enough questions in order to raise in order to have a BI tool over, ETL tool over here. Now the customer is like, only for renaming, I don't want to purchase any of the ETL tool. Mm-hmm. So that's why the ETL tool is not yet successful in this particular organization. But in future, as the data length increases, the complexity increases, that is likely a chance that...
Because I can see that there are so many fields available for you, and you're saying that the data gets multiplied, and you know there are data type changes that needs to happen.
So the organization which I'm speaking about is, they have just given and tried of using a BI tool. So they are at the initial stage. So if they move to the much more ahead stage, obviously they will purchase some of the ETL tool as per their requirement.
So the data is anyway structured that's coming from SAP, is it?
Sorry.
The data coming from SAP, it's structured and...
So my organization has ABAP developers who in turn creates all this table. So everything, all the joinings, etc., gets captured into that particular table. And you can, you just have to connect the table to your BI tool, and all the data, you don't have to perform any cleaning operation. Only thing is that you need to write logic and aggregate the data as required.
Okay, so only the dashboarding part is required.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So one more thing is that I could bring to the notice is, in many organizations, what happens is when they are using the tool for the first time, they produce two separate instances. One is the quality server and one is the production server. So all the operation that we need to perform happens at the quality level. And once everything is done, the data comes in a structured way, like a correct way, and we get a final approval, then every data moves to the production server. So my customer actually does this particular quality and production testing. So while migrating from quality to the production server, I need to replicate all this entire process, like the data renaming, the data type changing, everything else. So this is one of the painful point if the customer has a quality and the production server at a separate instance. So you need to reconnect, like Tableau has an option of replacing the data source. So it has benefited me much much better way. But if any of the tool does not have this, then there is a like a headache. Like you have to do all this stuff right from the scratch. So this is also a pain point with the SAP. So that's all with the presentation. This is something, everything was related to the SAP HANA. If you have any question, then please feel free to ask.
Hello.
Anyone? Yep.
Again. Yep. So I just had a question about the structure that R1 was based on. So there was a layer called application, correct? So is that a backend thing that is happening between these layers where, you know, there's verification going on?
Actually, my internet goes off. Can you just repeat the question?
Yeah. So in the R1 product that was initially launched by SAP, there are three, correct? So yes. There was a layer called application.
Yes, yes.
So is that a backend that we can say that it is there for all the other things that need to be kept,
okay.
Like verifying whether ticket raised was correct or not and confirming it with other departments?
You can treat the application, you are partially correct. It does reach, it allows you to recheck with the other department as well, but it act as a middle layer wherein you can enter the database. You can enter any information to the database and you can also pull out any information from the database. So that act as a middle layer of entering the data.
So application is part of the database that is coming on in the next part, or it's just it's a separate layer. Like you can actually access an application, like you're accessing the UI.
You will be using the HANA database using an application. The S4, which I've just mentioned over here, is an application layer added with the UI capabilities as well. So you have to have an application installed on your system wherein you can communicate with the database.
So for SAP, it's integrated. Otherwise, it used to be another layer.
Yeah. So mostly what we have done in our previous experience is we have used the RDBMS tool wherein we have written a SQL query in order to get our data. But in SAP, we are using a NoSAP command. NoSQL command. Wherein you don't have to enter any of the SQL queries. Everything is based on the UI. You enter any of the command, any of the input, it will automatically reproduce a script on the backend and it hit the database. You don't have to learn the SQL queries.
The table name and everything.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's how it works.
Okay. Thank you.
So if you have any question, then just ping me on my email ID. That's all with the session. Deepti ma'am, back to you.
He left the meeting.
Okay. So that's all with the session. Thank you guys for attending the session. Have a good day.